You on the notes? Okay, so welcome to week one of our series we're calling Rise Above. I know it's Easter Sunday, and we're going to talk about the resurrection. We're going to talk about Easter today, but I want to just get you clued in on this series, because all of us face things that threaten to pull us under. Isn't that right? There's some things that'll wreck us, that'll shipwreck us, that'll ruin our life. And God wants to get us to a place where we can rise above those things. And so today we say Easter, but it's really Resurrection Sunday, isn't it? It's the day that we celebrate Jesus as risen from the dead. But I realize there's some that may be listening. There's some that may even be here in person today. And today is just kind of more for you a day of candy, family gatherings, maybe a few pictures, some food, you know, that kind of thing. And so you're just kind of, you're here to help someone else out. And so today I've got something for the convinced and the questioning. So whichever you are today and whatever you are in the spectrum, I think this message today will encourage you and it will help you. And so oftentimes, though, we kind of gloss over the resurrection. We just kind of, we think about Jesus died on the cross for our sins, but he rose again. But really, we may believe, we may not believe, we may even believe and not know why it matters. We don't understand it. And so I want to say to you today that what you believe about the resurrection frames your faith. Amen. It's really a big thing. And so today I want to talk about the idea of rising above resurrection doubt. Resurrection doubt, okay? And so I'm going to make a bold claim this morning, and that is your life hinges on the resurrection of Jesus and what you do about it, what you decide to do, your faith, your lack of it, your quality of life even, your lack of it, your future or lack of it. Everything in life really hinges on the fact that Jesus rose from the dead and what you do with that information. And so whether you have resurrection doubt or whether you have resurrection belief, it actually does matter. If you acknowledge that Jesus was resurrected, raised from the dead to life, then you've got to believe that all the Bible must be true. It's because he was resurrected. And if you take away the resurrection, you take away following Jesus. Why? Because he's still dead. He's still dead, right? In fact, this is not a new question. The validity of the resurrection was being questioned in the church in Corinth, right? Shortly after Jesus lived on the earth. And so the Apostle Paul, who had gone there, been the church planner, he was writing by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to encourage them. He says in 1 Corinthians 15:17, "And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins." That's pretty heavy, isn't it? Yeah, so if Jesus wasn't raised from the dead, he's just simply another dead person. There's been a whole bunch of activity around a dead person, right? And so it's really, here's the thing, it's really all or nothing. How many of you love to shop at like a Sam's or a Costco? How many like to save that money? You know, some of y'all, you know, buy in bulk, you love to do it. Even if you go to a grocery store. None of you have ever gone in and said, "I think I just want one chip." And you opened the chip, took one out, licked it closed, put it back on the shelf, took your little chip over to the checkout, said, "I want just this one." Nobody's ever done that. I hope. None of you have ever gone to you go to Lowe's, you go to at the checkout, what do they got? All the batteries. You've never gone, opened the battery package and said, "I'll take this one, I'll take this one. Actually, I need a 9-volt, I need a AAA, and I need a AA. That's all." Nobody ever does that. Why? Because it's all or nothing. You either buy the whole package or you don't get any of it, right? And so the resurrection, the Bible, and following Jesus, they're not sold separately. They're all or nothing. All or nothing. So realizing how essential the resurrection is to our faith, let's look back. I want to look at some resurrection doubting theories. And so I'll just give you some things that people have said, and we're just going to kind of walk through it a little bit here this morning. Some people say, what if the resurrection story was really an allegory? And I know what you're thinking. What's an allegory? I was thinking that too as I was studying. I thought, well, I got to figure out what this means. It's a story with a hidden meaning. It's a story with a hidden meaning. So if the writers of the Bible were simply making up a story, then we've got, you know, just they were just trying to tell a story to make it all seem plausible and good. Then what about the people who saw Jesus alive after he was crucified on the cross? And so the Apostle Paul continues in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3. He says, Christ died for our sins just as the Scripture said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the Scripture said. He was seen by Peter, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom at that time of that writing are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later by all the apostles. Witnesses, right? There's just too many people who saw him to deny the fact that he was resurrected. All right? And I'm just imagine being, you know, put yourself, let's put this service back a couple thousand years ago. Imagine being the leader getting up and talking about the fact that Jesus was resurrected. Don't you think some people in the audience would have had some questions? How do you know? Imagine doubting Thomas. We call him doubting Thomas because he had to put his fingers in the hands, you know, where Jesus had the nails go through. But imagine him in talking to some people. He said, I put my finger in the place where the nail went in. Eyewitness. I mean, our whole judicial system is based on eyewitness, right? So they were eyewitnesses of his resurrection. Here's another theory. What if Jesus actually didn't really die? That's an interesting theory. Maybe after having the crown of thorns, which those thorns were about 3 inches long, beat into his head, maybe after being whipped 39 times with cat of nine tails, it had all these little different ends on it with whip, with bones and with metal in it, basically ripping and exposing his whole skeletal structure. Maybe after that, when he was hung on the cross with spikes through his hands and spikes through his feet, being left up there all day, imagine the bleeding that was going on. And then they took him down. Maybe he really wasn't dead. Maybe it was just a coma. Okay. If that were true, once they put him in the tomb, how would he have regained consciousness with the very lifeblood draining out of him? How would have that happened? How that would have happened? Amen? Amen. And then let's say he did wake up. How are you going to move the stone? How are you going to move the stone? Oh, and then if you got the stone moved, then what about the guards? They're out there guarding the tomb. And if that were true, then how would he have convinced his followers that he was the Messiah, that he was the Savior, when he was barely alive when they saw him, right? So the Bible says this in Romans 5:8, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die, not to almost die, to die for us. While we were still sinners. What great love. Amen. Jesus died. Jesus had to die. Jesus died because he had to pay. That was the only way to pay the price for our sins. That was the only way to work through all that we have done and to fully take that. So he died. And he said, well, what if the women were at the wrong tomb? I mean, you know, I mean, one of the biggest fights Kim and I have ever had in our life was over directions. I mean, actually, last week, we said something about east or west side of the building, and somebody sent a text. I forget who it was to who, but which side of the building is that? Right? I mean, I just got to confess my sin. Is that all right? Y'all good with that? So we had barely, Kim's very good with that. We were barely married. This was before phones, and this was when you actually had maps, right? And I grew up, my dad flew small airplanes, and when I was from a little kid, he would throw the map in my lap, and he knew where he was going. He'd tell me to navigate. So I had to learn to figure out north, south, east, and west. And he taught me things in that and helped me. And you know, and I'd done some teaching of Kim, and I thought she understood. And so I put the map in her lap, and she didn't know what to do with it. And I wasn't very nice. Again, I apologize. But you know what? We finally got there. But here's the thing. We all have lost our way. But maybe the women that day, they were at the wrong tomb. And while we're at it, did Peter and John also go to the wrong tomb? Because they came after. I mean, were there really multiple tombs with stones rolled away? With angels sitting out front? And by the way, did the angels get lost? And by the way, did they all have no body inside? Right? Would everyone in the city have been fooled by the wrong tomb? Because here's the thing. Pilate knew. The guards knew. The religious leaders knew. The guy who put the seal, because they sealed the tomb. The guy who put the seal on the tomb, he would have known which one was the tomb. Right? And by the way, why would the religious leaders have bribed the guards later to make up a fictitious story if he hadn't really raised from the dead? They were concerned about losing their power and their control. So they weren't at the wrong tomb. So let's just continue. Let's say he was not resurrected. What does that mean? Well, it means several things. If Christ was not resurrected, then at the beginning it means there's no God. That there's no God. If any of all of those resurrection doubting theories are correct, there's no God. We're here by some random chance. It's like the chance that your incredibly complex body came together by chance is less likely than me taking this watch off, taking it apart, removing all the components. Actually, you know, somebody just did this. You could throw it in the air and see if it came back as a watch. That's one way to look at it. The other thing you could do is you could put it in a bag and you could shake it until it came together as a watch on keeping the perfect time. Just think about it. What if you just shook it for an hour or two? All the components would be damaged and ruined. Right? How long would it take you have to shake that bag for that watch to come back together? 1 billion years? 6 billion years? And somehow all of that would come together. No, it never would. So to those questioning the resurrection in Corinth, here's what the Apostle Paul said, again in verse 14 and 15. If Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless. And your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God. He's saying he was alive, but he'd be dead if Christ wasn't raised from the dead. He says, and for we have said that Christ, God raised Christ from the grave. That can't be true if there's no resurrection of the dead. Now, here's the thing. Without the resurrection of Jesus, God's not real. He's not a real being. According to verse 14 that we just read, the second thought is here, if Christ is not resurrected, your faith is useless. There's no resurrection, there's no God, and if there's no God, then every prayer you pray is a waste. Reading your Bible is a waste. Attending church is a waste. Giving your finances to God is a waste. Everything the Bible says is a waste if Christ is not resurrected. In other words, there's no hope. There's no hope. I mean, I can't tell you how many people that I prayed with over the years, and they were hopeless, but they were reaching out for prayer. Why? Because they had a sliver of hope. But if there's no God, there's no hope. Which means life has no meaning. Life would have no meaning. The acclaimed Russian writer of the 19th century, some of you, I'm going to take you back to your school days, Leo Tolstoy, remember that name? He lived most of his life without a relationship with God. And here's what he wrote later in life. Listen to this. He said, my question, which at the age of 50 brought me to the verge of suicide, was the simplest of questions. It was, what will come of what I'm doing today or tomorrow? What will come of my whole life? Why should I live? Why wish for anything or do anything? It can also be expressed thus: is there any meaning in my life that the inevitable death awaiting me does not destroy? Written like a man with no hope. If Jesus was not resurrected from the dead, life has no meaning, and merely living is meaningless. But I got good news today. I got good news today. Here's what the Bible records in Matthew 28, verse 1. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. I just love that picture. That's when you talk conquering something. We're just going to move it out of the way and have a seat. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a dead faint. They were out of it. Then the angel spoke to the women. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you're looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead," and I love this, "just as he said he would happen." He promised it. They didn't understand it, but he promised it. They said, it says here, "Come see where his body was lying." So they went, what did? They went and looked. "And now go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead and that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." I want to just encourage you this morning. He is alive. I want to encourage you that in the deepest, darkest battles of your life, one of the things that you have to remember is what he told you. That's what the angel told the women. Remember what he told you. Remember. Well, they were talking about meeting Jesus in Galilee later. That's what that was about. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. But here's the thing. Well, you've got to remember what Jesus has said to you. You, in the darkest of times, the best thing you can do is remember his promises to you. You that are online, don't forget his promises to you. We've got to understand that they're real. Jesus said, the angel said here, he's risen from the dead. He's not here. He's gone. So the truth is, Jesus was resurrected. And here's the thing, that truth changes everything. Because Jesus is alive, let me give you three thoughts here this morning. Number one, hope is found in Jesus. Because God resurrected him, hope is found in Jesus. We all love a good comeback story, right? I love a good comeback story. I like sports, so I like them. You know, I was watching yesterday a little bit of that U of H and Baylor game. And you know, you can't go wrong with two Texas teams. And just for the rest of you, NCAA men's basketball tournament, okay? Final four, trying to play for the get into the championship game. And I know somebody's been very involved in the U of H team. And so I was rooting for U of H. And so, you know, I was hoping for a comeback. And we're so far down, there was no comeback. Now, I didn't get to watch a UCLA-Gonzaga game last night, but I heard this morning that in the overtime, at the end, the Gonzaga player threw the ball from midcourt and made a three-point, you know, score to win the game. We love a comeback story. I mean, Gonzaga isn't, I mean, it's been more of a powerhouse lately, but I remember years ago when they first came in the tournament and they won, it was like, wow, this is great. Everybody's rooting for the underdog, right? We all love that. So being raised from the dead, isn't that the ultimate comeback story? I mean, how are you going to top that, right? And when we hear this and when we recognize that the resurrection is true, I think it can give us some real hope for today. Amen. That Jesus, he is our hope. And so if you've already surrendered your life to Jesus, here's what 1 Peter 1 says. "All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is by his great mercy that we have been born again." Why? Because God raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Now we live with expectation. How are you living? You don't have to answer out loud, but how are you living? Do you have expectation? Oh, yeah, I've had expectations, but I've kind of gotten away from that because every time I have an expectation, I always get disappointed. But I want to tell you, even if you get disappointed, you can live with expectation because of the resurrection. Because here's why. Look at verse 4. And we have a priceless inheritance, an inheritance that is kept in heaven for us, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach of change and decay. Amen. In other words, what's waiting for us is not affected at all by what's going on down here. And God's holding it back. We won't get it until we get to heaven. But there is an inheritance waiting for those who faithfully serve Him and live for Him. Amen. So good. See, because Jesus is alive, because we can then have a relationship with Jesus, you can live with that expectation. You can live with hope. And some of you, I know you're thinking, but Pastor, my life has been so difficult. I know all of us have been through things we thought we'd never go through. Can't imagine we'd ever go through those things. But here we are. And here's what Peter continues to write by the Holy Spirit. So be truly glad. That's hard to swallow. Here's why, though. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. Just remember, compared to eternity, we're living on a dot of an infinite line. It's just a little bit. He said, this is what trials do in our life. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purified gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you, what, much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. So not only was He resurrected, but He's coming back again, closer than it was yesterday. And if we go through a trial, as we go through that trial well, our faith is tested. It's proved to be genuine, right? And then there's what? Praise, glory, and honor awaiting us when Jesus returns. That's good news. That's a reason to have hope. So maybe you've been through some stuff this year. Maybe there's been death in your family. Maybe there's been dreams dashed. Maybe there's been a job loss. Maybe you're still putting your home back together after the freeze. Whatever's been going on, here you are. Look, you're here. You're in service. You're watching online. Your faith has been tested, but it's genuine. You're here still to praise the Lord and give Him thanks and give Him glory for the fact that He is alive. And because He is alive, you have hope in Him. Amen? Here's the second thing. If Christ is resurrected, then death is conquered. Yeah. Death is conquered. I've thought more about that in this last year. This last year I've done more funerals than any other year in ministry. None of them COVID, by the way. But I've thought about this. It's been with grieving family after grieving family. And you know, death and dying are very common fears. And if we live out of that fear, we can miss out on life on earth. We can miss life. But because Jesus has been raised from the dead, He not only conquered sin, He did conquer death as well. So apparently in this church in Corinth, they were questioning kind of the underlying thing that Paul had been writing about there in 1 Corinthians 15 is the resurrection of the dead. In other words, people who were not Jesus. And they were basically saying, once you're dead, you're dead. There's nothing more. There's no existence after you die. To which Paul writes, by the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians 15, 16, and he says, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. In other words, these two things go together. You cannot separate Christ being raised from your own resurrection at some point in the future. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you're guilty of your sins. Verse 18, in that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. I mean, if there's no resurrection of the dead, right? If Christ is not raised, then they're lost. Verse 19, and if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. We can't. Jesus is not just about this life. He's about all of your future, including into eternity. Verse 20, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. In other words, because Christ is alive, you can count on the resurrection of the dead. Every person who has died is going to be resurrected. Now, you're going to be resurrected someday too. You're going to be resurrected to eternal life, or you'll be resurrected to eternal death, based on the decision in this life. So, in other words, there's a heaven to gain and there's a hell to shun. We've got to make a choice in this life. So, what does resurrection of the dead mean for those who've given their lives to Christ? Let me say it again. What does the resurrection of the dead mean for those who've given their life to Jesus? It does not mean the walking dead. I don't watch a show, but I've seen the commercial. That's not what it means. Here's what it means, verse 54 of 1 Corinthians 15. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, that's what's waiting for you. Because Christ is resurrected, what's waiting for you is a body that will never die. This one will die, unless Jesus returns before you die. But this one will decay and pass away. You'll leave this earthly body on the earth. But there is a body waiting for you that will never die. This scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Now listen. For sin is the sting that results in death. Because sin came into the earth, our bodies are going to die. And the law gives sin its power. But thank God he gives us victory over sin and death through Christ, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Isn't that awesome? So, let me say it again, just for clarity. Because of the sin that came into the earth through Adam and Eve, physical death entered our world. And listen, we miss those who have died, who've gone on before us, right? And so, but because of Jesus and the resurrection, the grave will not keep us forever. The grave will not keep them forever. We will be resurrected. And so, we'll receive that resurrected body because Jesus is alive. Isn't that awesome news? And we're never going to die. We're going to be alive if we belong to him forever. So because Jesus is alive, we can have hope in Jesus. Death is conquered. And here's the third thing. He is with us. He is with us. That matters. No matter how dark your life is right now, regardless of what you're going through, you don't have to face the battle alone. I mean, here's what I know about all of us. We all face, how many of you battle some thoughts? We all have thoughts that go through our head. We can get locked in, we can get stuck in those thoughts, and we can feel like we're alone. And here's what Hebrews 13:5 says, for God has said, I will never leave you nor, and I will never abandon you. Let me just help you with that. He also said Jesus was going to be resurrected from the dead. Was he? Yes. If he was, and he kept that promise, and he cannot lie. Don't you think he'll keep this one? Amen. He hasn't abandoned you. You just don't feel like he's right there. And that's where we get in trouble. Because we're living by our feelings. We're living by what we think and what we feel. So it's verse 6 says, so we can say with confidence. And by the way, let me confidently say with confidence that your confidence is really important. You have to know, you have to live. God is with me. He has not abandoned me. He's not forsaken me. And he never will. That doesn't mean we do whatever we want. We're trying to follow him. We're trying to please him. But we know that we do that with him with us. He said, so it's, we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. So I will have no fear. What can mere people do to me? Now, if you think about most of what we are fearful about, it has to do with what others think, what others say, what's going to happen, are they going to reject? All of it is related to people. But the Lord's our helper. We don't have to be afraid of that. So if you've given your life to Jesus, Jesus is with you. In fact, he's not only with you, He calls us, and you all are doing it. You here are watching are doing it, but maybe there's somebody that you don't have this as a part of your life. He calls us to be part of a local church because he doesn't even want us to be physically alone in this journey. He doesn't want us to be isolated and all by ourselves. The Bible even says he puts us in families for a reason. Amen. It's not good to be alone. He puts you in church for a reason because it's not good to be alone. It's not good to fight a spiritual battle alone. You need a church home. So there's some of the greatest people I know in the world right a part of this church. If you say, I need some people to journey with, then come journey with us. Maybe you're online right now. Journey with us online. Get involved. Comment. Post there. Let them pray for you. God's got great things that he wants to do in our lives. We just got to know he's with us, and we don't have to do this alone. Amen? Here's your next step today. Believe Jesus is alive and trust him with your life. Why? Why? Because it changes everything. Here's the thing. Don't choose Jesus because he's the best option. I like Christian churches versus the other stuff. Choose Jesus because he's the only one that's resurrected from the dead and people are following him today. All the rest of them are not alive. Jesus is alive. Come on, can we praise the Lord for that this morning? Amen. Now this morning I asked you to take your connection cards out, and you that are online, go ahead and get your connection cards out as well. And I want to just ask you a series of questions here, and I want to just help you locate your spiritual condition. And for some of you today, it's all up on the screen there. You're going to see it, but maybe you've already believed. I want you to put on the top of that connection card a big A. Just put a big A. I've already believed. And then what I want you to do is just begin to pray quietly under your breath. For some of you today, you're saying, I have been unsure. I have not been at a place where I've really had faith in Christ. And maybe you've had questions about the resurrection. But you say, you know what, Pastor? I'm believing today. I want you to write a big B on the top of your card. For some of you might be saying, you know, I'm considering Jesus. I'm new to the idea of Jesus, and I'm considering. I'm not ready yet, but I'm considering Jesus. And I want you to put a C on top of your connection card. And I want you to know this. When you put a C, I'm not going to show up at your door, send somebody to your door, but we are going to pray. We're going to ask God to help you take the next step to B. And then for some of you today, you're a D. And your D is, I don't think I'll ever believe. I don't think I am. I'm here for somebody else today, but I don't think I'll believe. And if that's you, I want you to honestly put that D down. And again, we're going to pray for you, but we're not going to show up at your door. We're not going to put any kind of pressure on you. But here's what I know. Get ready for the next year. Because I know God's going to do everything in his power to draw you to himself. Because he wants a relationship with you. And it's going to be a good one. Amen. So let's bow our heads this morning after you put the letter on today, on your card. And for those that are believing today, would you say this prayer with me and with those that have already made this decision? Just say this out loud with me. Let's pray. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from my old life. And I choose to turn to you. God, I do believe you resurrected Jesus from the dead. Jesus, I ask you, forgive my sins. Make me a new person. I surrender my life to you. Lead my life. I belong to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, can we celebrate that today with those who made that decision?